Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Secret of the Dark Forest by Vasily Mahanenko. Translated by Natalia Nikitin. Narrated by Jonathan Yen. Chapter 1. The Emperor.
Man, is there more interesting stuff on the way, or can we start getting some answers out of you?
Anastaria's simple question sounded like a crack of thunder in the surrounding world, snapping everyone out of it. The world exploded. After seeing a dragon with their own eyes, hearing the announcement that they could play on the side of Cartus, and, in general, after a long and hard battle, the players tried to get everything off their chests all at once. The area was shaken by various exclamations like,
"Whoa! A dragon?"
"They said they didn't exist, but this small fry knows them."
"Who the heck is that?"
There was such a din that I couldn't hear myself think, let alone try to answer Anastaria. Because of the noise, few heard the quiet clap of the opening of the portal. A little way off, a new herald had appeared in Barliona. The Emperor ascended the throne, and his envoys appeared at the very same moment. With advisors, it was more complicated, since they had to come with a background. But I had a feeling that this matter would be resolved in the course of the day. It's not as if the developers would have launched all of this without the necessary preparations. As I glanced around the raging crowd of players, the herald came up to Tisha, who was gazing into the distance, eyes wide. The girl was still in a state of shock and unable to come to terms with seeing two of her closest relatives become heads of empires.
"Princess," the herald bowed, "please follow me. The Emperor is waiting for you and your young man," the envoy bowed to Slate, "at the palace."
"Me? Us?"
The intellect imitator inside Tisha did a stellar job in playing a girl who was still in a state of shock and struggling to understand what was going on. Her vacant gaze wandering over the players, her grip on Slate's hand, as if it was the only thing keeping the headman's daughter in this world. Such an exquisite piece of programming really should have been seen in a theater instead of wasting away at the edge of the world.
"That is correct, Princess." The herald once again bowed his head.
"But I can't come alone. My brothers, they are still in Beatwick, tied up and—"
"Unfortunately," the herald's cheerful expression faded and his tone became more subdued, "we cannot take them with us. They are being sent to Cartus, where they will continue to serve the Dark Lord. Please, Princess, the Emperor is expecting you."
"What will happen to Beth and to Mayan? Will they come with me?"
Tisha had to make sure. "I can't say much about Beth, but the fact that the princess has remembered me is a good sign. As soon as I get away from this madhouse, there may be a chance of getting a nice bonus from this member of the imperial family. I wouldn't say no to some extra gold." Instead of responding, the herald pointed to Elizabeth, who clung to her newly regained husband and children. While Mariana hid her face in her father's embrace, Clowder tried to slip out of his mother's strong grip and get a better look at everything. Totally irrepressible, that boy. Another portal appeared next to Beth, out of which stepped a different herald.
"High Priestess, you are expected in Anhurs. I'm sorry, but the matter cannot wait."
"Yes, of course. My husband and children—"
"They shall come with you. Please, come this way." The herald pointed to the portal.
"Mayan,"
Beth turned to me,
"when you come to Anhurs, please make sure to come and visit me."
"Thank you, High Priestess. I will definitely drop by."
I bowed my head, noting Anastaria's narrowing eyes. Aha! She had no idea that the High Priestess of Iluna in Malabar had been replaced.
Beth, smiled the priestess. Just call me Beth. I await you in Anhurs.
With these words, the woman disappeared into the portal, pulling Mariana and Clouder after her. Theodore, Beth's husband, glanced at the portal and at the herald, and then came over to me.
I usually pay my own debts, regardless of any position that my wife may hold, he said in a low bass, and handed me a scroll. 2 years of imprisonment have inspired me to write this work. Read it. Perhaps you may find it useful.
Item acquired. A treatise on imprisonment and ways of staying yourself. Number of pages, 240. Upon reading and providing correct answers, 70%, to the questionnaire on this treatise, plus 20 intellect, plus 3 agility, plus 3 stamina, plus 3 strength. Duration, unlimited.
Theodore shook my hand and entered the portal. Only at that moment did I realize that we were surrounded by a strange silence. It felt like deja vu. Had Renox dropped in on us again? I looked around and saw that the players had split into two groups. The first, the larger one, made up of about 90% of the players that escaped from Beatwick, withdrew a little way off and started to summon their pets for returning to the more populous regions. These players tried not to make too much noise and disturb the second group. The latter consisted of the leaders of all the clans, their deputies and shadow leaders, such as Evelyn. They were now observing the conversations of the NPCs with some interest. Anastaria, who stood next to me, was even making a video of the whole thing, a movie camera icon flashing above her head.
Princess, the First Herald once again reminded us of his presence. It's time. The High Priestess is already in Anhurs, and as for Mayan, the Emperor will speak to him in person, right after you. He will be taken to the palace a little later.
All right. Tisha brightened up and turned towards the blacksmith. Let's go, darling. Father won't dare to keep us apart.
When the couple disappeared into the portal, other portals began to open, one after another. Heralds stepped out of each one, walked up to the rescued Beatwick villagers, and took them to the mainland. I don't know how it was for other players, but for each rescued villager I received a 10-point reputation increase with the Malabar Emperor. 135 Beatwick residents turned into 1,350 reputation points. After a few minutes, only players remained by the destroyed Cartus Castle.
I see that you've found yourself in possession of an interesting scroll.
Just as I thought, Evelyn was the first to speak. Anastaria may be a strong-willed girl, but she wouldn't barge in with her uncle present, assuming he really was her uncle. The chain of command had to be respected. Eckler wasn't present among the fighters, so Evelyn clearly intended to take the situation in hand.
I have a rough idea of what that is, so I won't ask you to show me its properties. Read through it carefully before you try answering the questions. It may not be clear from the description, but you'll have only 2 attempts to complete the questionnaire. And now we have to move on to less pleasant things. You probably realize that you've put all the high-level players at a very big disadvantage today. Just think. Some upstart, excuse my bluntness, took it upon himself to do what even Anastaria could not, direct an inter-clan raid,
and we're talking about an upstart who is completely unknown, without any kith or kin or any real levels. Can you imagine the storm this will kick up on the forums? The clan's ratings will take a big tumble, and you'll be the only one to blame. This is the tricky situation I would like to discuss with you.
Stop handling this moron with kid gloves. Stick him on the blacklist and rub him out every chance you get,
interrupted Plinto.
Plinto, I will settle this matter myself.
Evelet's voice was frosty, putting the sham clan leader back in his place.
Quit shutting me down all the time. Don't do that. Don't say this. I've really had it with you. This jackass has decided that he's better than our clan. Sitting on his high horse and showing off how the clans mean nothing to him. Those cursed chess pieces are his handiwork. Plinto.
Evelet didn't shout, but his voice was sharp enough to send one for respawn.
I've been putting up with your shenanigans for what seems like ages, but enough is enough. You will stop bringing our clan into disrepute as of now.
You and your clan and your decisions can go to hell,
Plinto fired back.
You can take it all and stick it where the sun don't shine. You've got me really shaking in my boots. And as for you, you little shit,
he said, turning to me,
we'll catch up in person later. You'll regret making that pawn for a long, long time. Our meetings will be frequent, and we'll all end the same way. Like this.
Suddenly, Plinto dashed towards me, unleashing throwing knives that left a trail of green poison behind them. I only had enough time for a brief chuckle. Plus, 350 level mobs were unable to bring me down, but this one unbalanced individual was apparently going to finish the job.
"Chill it, handsome,"
came Anastaria's voice, and a dome surrounded me. A bubble.
"Phoenix, attack!"
Phoenix's entire raid group reacted immediately. Plinto didn't even have time to get near me before he was slowed, had petrification cast on him, and was sent for respawn a few seconds later. In other words, he was disposed of quickly and professionally. Something else was bugging me now. Earlier, the system, on behalf of the Emperor, informed the players of the ban on PvP fighting. Had the Emperor's previous order been revoked? Strange, I had no memory of any announcements of that sort.
"Legion!" there came a shout. "Phoenix has broken the truce! Waste them!"
"Phoenix, circle formation!"
Anastaria's reaction was instantaneous.
"Vlad, Paul, make a portal and bring all our fighters here."
"Silence!"
I never thought that Evelet was capable of shouting so loudly. The two groups that were about to dive into battle froze, looking at each other in surprise. The other clans got out of the way and were also murmuring in indignation. Hardly surprising, since they had just been deprived of one heck of a spectacle.
"The Dark Legion clan has no claims against the Phoenix clan, and thanks them for subduing Plinto," said Evelet, quickly diffusing the situation. "There will be no battle now. I will personally throw anyone that attacks any Phoenix player out of the clan, even if they do it in self-defense. Is that clear?"
Evelet confirmed my hunch that the PvP mode was still forbidden. Its shutdown wasn't system-wide, but localized, so both Plinto and a number of Phoenix members were about to be docked some reputation points. Silence descended on the ruins of the castle. The Legion players stared at their leader in incomprehension, and the players of other clans started to whisper amongst themselves, wondering who the heck this was, and why was he suddenly commanding the Dark Legion clan? "Damn it," came a grumble from Anastaria as she read the message that appeared in front of her. "Our reputation with the Emperor has gone down."
"Has everyone calmed down? Then let's get back to business."
Evelyn looked over the bewildered players and turned to me.
"As I already said, damage has been done to the reputation of all the clans, so I'll make an official statement. I call upon a herald and request your assistance."
A herald immediately appeared next to Evelyn.
"You called me, Evelyn. If your summons lacked a good reason, you shall be punished."
"According to the decision of the Clan Assembly, I am now the leader of the Dark Legion Clan. I ask you to bear witness to this fact,"
Evelyn said, handing the herald a sheet of paper.
"Plinto is being excluded from the clan. We are no longer responsible for his actions."
"Accepted."
The air was filled with the ringing voice of the herald.
"Henceforth, Evelyn is the head of the Dark Legion clan."
"Is that all?"
"No. On behalf of the Dark Legion clan, I declare Shaman Mahan persona non grata. He is now officially added to the blacklist, and all clan members will be informed of the fact. Starting tomorrow, any clan member that has had a chance to attack him but failed to do so will be automatically excluded. Herald, I ask you to verify that this directive is being adhered to."
"Do you agree to the conditions for adding Mahan, who has positive reputation with the Malabar Empire, the Malabar Emperor, Goddess Iluna, Priestesses of Goddess Iluna, Prike Mine Guards, and the Krong Province, to the blacklist?"
The herald's voice now had an icy edge to it.
"His reputation with other factions will not be taken into account."
Anastaria, Undigit, and other clan leaders were looking from me to Evelyn and back again in surprise. In Evelyn's case, it was on account of his words, but I didn't get the meaning of the surprised look shot in my direction. Nor did I get why the herald listed all the Malabar factions that I had encountered when playing as a shaman, and why he had left others out, such as the Shaman Council and the Dark Lord of Cartus.
"Yes, this is the decision of the Clan Assembly."
Evelyn handed the herald another paper. The new clan leader didn't simply look pleased, but rather had turned into one big smile, as had the number twos standing nearby.
"Now we just have to write a name here, and that name is Mahan. The Dark Legion clan is putting him on the official blacklist."
"So be it."
The herald took the paper from Evelyn, after which a gong sounded some way off.
"Is that all?"
"Yes. Thank you, herald."
Judging by Evelyn's expression, what had just taken place was something that he'd waited a very long time for. I seriously didn't get it, but clearly something unusual had just gone down. Some of the players were still wearing expressions that read, "No way did this just happen."
"Thank you."
I decided to clear the atmosphere, which was beginning to grow a little too charged. "Not everyone has the privilege of being put on the official blacklist of the second clan in the Empire." I'm not sure if it was something I said, but the surrounding world exploded for the second time in the past hour. Many of the players were speaking to each other or shouting things, while others stood there with glassy eyes, probably typing up forum messages after hopping back into reality. A minute later, the buzz had somewhat died down, and Evelyn smiled once again.
"It seems that you are not too familiar with what being put on the official blacklist actually means, so allow me to enlighten you. Each clan has two blacklists, a general one and an official one. The general one contains players who've been making trouble for the clan. For example, Anastaria, Hellfire, and so on. When a player from our clan runs across a player from the general list, they get a message that there is an enemy nearby and they should take heed. It's quite easy to end up on the main list, since any player with the relevant level of authorization can add you. But then there is the second list, the official one, where, for each player, the clan pays a tax to the Empire and sacrifices its reputation. For example, you will be costing us 5,000 gold a day, as well as daily reputation reduction, with all the factions listed by the Herald. The reputation of each clan member that signed under the list will fall. On the first day, it will fall by 1 point, on the second by 2, the third by 4, the fourth by 8, and so on. All this irrespective of whether the player on the blacklist is inside the game or has logged out. The timer is ticking in any case. Thus, in just 3 weeks' time, any reputation, whatever its initial level, will tumble down to hatred. This will be true for all those who signed under it. Putting a player on the official list requires at least 500 signatures, and the paper that I just handed the Herald contains just over 4,000. Now we come to the main point of putting someone on this blacklist. As soon as someone from the clan runs across the player on this official list, they must do all they can to send that player for respawn. They would not be penalized with a PK mark, and would be able to do this even inside a town. Members of other clans or unaffiliated players will receive a message that the Dark Legion clan will pay them 5,000 gold for killing you. The Heralds are responsible for ensuring that clan members comply with the compulsory attack policy. They will also count the number of times you're killed by other players. Even the safe zones are ineffective against the official list. This blacklist is very popular with those who wish to punish some particular person. It is expensive, of course, but sometimes it's worth it. There are around 40,000 players in my clan, with an average level of 137. You have a day to run and hide. In the following 2 weeks, our people will be looking for you very thoroughly. As soon as the reputation of each person that signed under the list gets reduced to hatred, you will be removed from the blacklist automatically, if I do not do so earlier. But that's never going to happen. Evelyn looked like the cat that got the cream. That's all from me.
Evelyn, what are you up to?
Came Anastaria's subdued whisper. So that's that. She was no longer interested in Mayan the dragon. She had to get to the bottom of whatever plot the leader of number twos had concocted.
You'll find out soon enough, my dear.
Evelyn gave another radiant smile.
Man, you're really quite a find. You've gained positive reputation with so few Malabar factions, and all of them exactly the ones I was after.
Mahan, the Emperor wishes to speak with you.
With all this talk, I hadn't even noticed that a herald had appeared next to me.
Yes, of course, I mumbled.
But before I could step into the portal, I was stopped by a gentle touch from Mirida. Everyone seemed to have completely forgotten about her.
Wait.
Mirida bit her lip, as if trying to come to a hard but necessary decision. She finally breathed out, leant over to me, and quickly blurted out,
I want to tell you why I came to Beatwick. It doesn't matter what you'll think of me, but you ought to know the truth. My name is Marina.
Yes, that very same, she said when she saw my reaction.
I'm marking a spot on the map. Let's meet up when there's a chance. Please come. There is a lot I must tell you.
A message flashed before my eyes. A location somewhere near Anhur's had been marked on my map.
If you don't turn up, I'll understand. But give me a chance to explain. Please.
Marina let go of my hand and stepped aside. It was just as well that I was already pumped full of emotions by this point, so I took the news that I was looking at the cause of my 8-year prison sentence calmly enough.
A day, Mahan. You have a day, repeated Evelyn. Then the hunt will begin.
It came out rather overplayed and over the top, like a villain in an old film giving his final speech. I don't know why, but it made me smile. Bearing in mind that all of this was being recorded on video and would be uploaded for public viewing, I knew the Dark Legion clan would be looking forward to some dark times. A bit of a tautology there, putting a low-level player on an official blacklist just for successfully directing an inter-clan raid looked stupid and cast the clan in an extremely unfavorable light. But Evelyn didn't look like a stupid man, and he had probably thought this through in advance.
Please wait here.
As soon as I stepped out of the portal, the herald gave me a few minutes to look around and enjoy the view of the palace after its rearrangement by Garanika. Even in this sorry state, the Malabar Emperor's residence was magnificent. The stones, the dust, the pockmarked walls and broken statues scattered around the territory. All this destruction only underlined the excellence of the spectacle. You got the feeling that it took several teams of designers to achieve the proper ruined palace look.
I even somewhat regret that I didn't see all this splendor in its better days,
came the words of the former Beatwick headman, the ex-master of the Empire of Cardus, and the current Emperor of Malabar, as he walked up to me.
You have to give it to the previous Emperor. He had taste. Come, it's time to reward our hero.
I don't know what it was, the destroyed palace or the moon being in Aquarius, but as I walked behind the Emperor, I totally failed to experience any excitement over the anticipated bonuses. I had a feeling that my inner zoo was completely disheartened and succumbed to apathy. The hoarding hamster was an especially sorry sight. Under normal circumstances, he should have been flying after the Emperor, trying to get his paws on all possible bonuses and stuffing them in his pockets. Far from it. He was sitting and gazing sadly at the downcast greed toad, barely holding back his tears. I opened my quest log and scanned through its contents to stave off the infectious melancholy.
Night Terror of the Village. Rare. Completed. Reward, +400 reputation with the Krong Province, +500 experience, +80 silver coins, a rare item from Headman's Stores. Search for the Dark Coordinator. Unique. Completed. Reward, +4,000 reputation with the Malabar Empire, +4,000 experience, +10,000 gold coins, a scaling item from the Emperor's Stores. The Last Hope, Step 3, Rare. Time until the wolves respawn, 2 months, 21 days. The Eye of the Dark Widow. The quest will become available at level 100. Legendary. The Way of the Shaman, Step 3. Completion of the trial to become a great shaman. Class-based. Restoration of Justice. Class-based. Unique. I was about to remove the wolf quest, but something within me objected. You don't just ditch quest chains. It's not like I have to feed it, or as if there's a limit on the number of quests. At the same time, it would be very interesting to see what crazy things the developers cooked up with this quest chain. Pulling out those arrows was something else. Just remembering it made me shudder. In all likelihood, it comes with a pleasant reward at the end, even if it's a low-level one. A happy squeak of the hamster, who caught a whiff of a bonus, was barely audible. My brain gears seemed totally out of whack. Restoration of Justice is a good quest, but to complete it, I would have to hike all the way to Sarist Province, where my reputation is at Hatred, thanks to its governor. I wondered if my reputation with the governor could be higher than with that of the province itself. Would they kick me out straight away, or would I actually have a chance to speak to Pronto? I guess I'll find out when I get there. It will still be a while until I'm able to do the Eye of the Dark Widow quest. Two quests are completed, so it looks like I have nothing left aside from the Path of the Shaman and Restoration of Justice. According to the timer, the trial for becoming the Great Shaman was still 2 months away. Even that made me a bit sad. In Beatwick, I started to feel like a protagonist in global game events, but as soon as it was all over, I immediately turned back into a standard ordinary player, of which there's a multitude in Barliona. Once again, I became one of the many. Other than access to the palaces, there are no benefits, aside from the positive regard of the Emperor and the Dark Lord. With my level of reputation, I could only walk around the palace, watch it being restored and regain its former brilliance, and watch covetously as Anastaria and Hellfire receive unique and rewarding quests. There was little doubt that the entire Phoenix leadership had gained esteem with the Emperor. The Emperor took me to a small room lit by a couple of torches. Aside from a hint of daylight from a narrow window, the place was submerged in gloom. A small wooden table on curved legs was the only object that interrupted the surrounding emptiness. I would never have thought that such rooms could exist in the palace.
From what I've come to know of you, you have no special need of elaborate rewards.
The Emperor smiled and picked up a scroll from the table.
You are being given this item for completing the Night Terror of the Village assignment. I no longer hold the position of the headman, but I can't fail to reward the man who found my sklick. You did a good job.
With these words, Nati handed me the scroll. Reward for the Night Terror of the Village quest, +400 reputation with the Krong Province, +500 experience, +80 silver coins, Jewelcraft Recipe, Malachite Jewelry Box with Lapis Inlays.
I quickly learned the recipe, opened the recipe book, and looked at its description.
Malachite jewelry box with lapis inlays. Description: a neat and sturdy box for jewelry. Can carry 10 items. Crafting stat bonus: the box can carry an additional crafting number of items. Item class: rare. Minimum level: 50. Crafting requirements: minimum jewel craft level: 40. Ingredients: 2 pieces of malachite, 2 pieces of lapis lazuli, 4 bronze wires. Instruments: jeweler's tools.
Well, that'll do, I guess. On the one hand, it's a new recipe. On the other, a bit of a disappointment. I was hoping for more. The expression on my face made the Emperor laugh.
You definitely need to work on controlling your emotions better. You look like someone just offered you something disagreeable. Bear in mind that the assignment to find the Sklik could have been removed altogether as soon as the battle started in Beatwick, but I decided to leave it in place. Now, let's move on to a reward that should be more to your liking. The search for the former me.
Reward for the search for the Dark Coordinator quest. Plus 4,000 reputation with the Malabar Empire. Plus 4,000 experience. Plus 10,000 gold coins. A scaling item from the Emperor's stores. The choice of the item is up to you.
I noticed that exactly 10,000 gold coins fell into my purse. It turned out that this amount was already free of the usual imperial tax. I quickly tried to calculate what it should have been in the first place, but couldn't come up with a round number, only fractions. Never mind.
There are 5 items on the table that would suit you, continued the Emperor. You can choose one of them. You wouldn't be able to buy these items from Thracinians even if your reputation with them was exalted. You will be able to see the properties of the items only after you make your choice. So choose carefully.
No looking at their properties? How the heck am I supposed to make a choice like this? 5 items were lying on the table in a neat row. A shaman's hat with horns, like the one Almas had, a feathered cloak, almost identical to the one I was wearing, boots, pants, and bracers. Disbelieving the Emperor, I checked the properties of each item, but they really were hidden. How to make a choice? My spirits sunk even further. How long can I keep playing these guessing games? Bah! They can go to hell with their rewards.
I respectfully decline your gift, I said, firmly returning the Emperor's gaze.
I refuse to make an uninformed decision. It's better to refuse everything than forever regret picking the worst out of the lot. I would like to thank the Emperor for this opportunity, but no, I will not choose.
Your choice has been made, the Emperor replied calmly, and immediately the table with all the items disappeared. The heralds will see you out.
My hoarding hamster lifted his head, looked me in the eye, and then let it drop again. He had no fight left in him.
Mahan, you're here!
As soon as we left the room, Tisha suddenly appeared next to us.
Father, have you thought of a reward for him?
He refused it,
the Emperor replied just as calmly.
Mahan thinks that the Emperor is unworthy of granting him a reward.
Mahan!
Tisha froze next to me, astonished.
Is this true?
I don't think I like the direction that this conversation is taking. The intellect imitator is doing a great job of making me look like an obnoxious and ungrateful bastard who rudely refused a gift. in your dreams, I happen to be capable of standing up for myself. I took out 5 cursed rings and, after hiding their properties, handed them to Tisha. Choose one and put it on without looking.
But they can't be read, said the girl in surprise.
Exactly. Just choose one and put it on. Tisha took one of the rings, which reduced strength by 5%, put it on her finger and exclaimed,
It's a cursed ring, Mahan. What is the meaning of this?
As soon as the ring was put on, its properties became accessible to the wearer. Tisha angrily pulled off the ring and threw it towards me.
Why did you do that? I trusted you. You...
Hold on, Tisha. The Emperor interrupted her and turned to address me. Open the properties of the other rings and hand them over to me. There didn't seem anything wrong with Nati's request, so I picked up the ring Tisha threw down and dropped it together with the rest into the Emperor's hand.
Did you make them?
The Emperor took a careful look at each ring. Yes, I made them from the materials gathered in Beatwick, but after the inverters did their job, only items like these came out, no matter what I did.
What do you plan to do with them?
I'll take them to Elizabeth. She can bless them. They're quite useless otherwise.
Do you still have any of the amulets that you made in Beatwick?
The former headman kept up his confounding line of questioning. Something began to stir in me that I thought was gone forever. Genuine interest. What can the Emperor want with my rings and amulet? Strange. Yes, here it is. I took out the novice's amulet out of the bag and handed it to Nati. I thought that as soon as he took the amulet, he would immediately turn into a vagrant. But emperors were immune to such things, by the looks of it. Nati gave me back 4 rings, leaving only one for himself. He took it in one hand, and the amulet in the other, and then did something I thought completely impossible. He combined them together. A bright sun shone through his hands, and when the glow faded, both the ring and the amulet disappeared, as if they never existed. A pleased smile appeared on the Emperor's face.
Dad?
Tisha was looking wide-eyed at her father.
You just...
destroyed something that belonged to another?
The Emperor raised an eyebrow.
I know. Mayan's losses will be reimbursed. 100 gold for the ring and 1,000 for the amulet.
As soon as he uttered those words, I received a message that 770 gold had fallen into my purse.
But that's not the important part. Firstly, Mayan showed me that I was wrong to offer him a blind choice. And secondly, I have an assignment for him.
A blind choice? Asked Tisha.
Yes. I offered him a choice of 5 items with concealed properties. He refused to choose. Now I understand why. It seems that he hasn't forgotten who I was before becoming emperor, so his suspicions are not groundless.
I was lucky that the emperor was so clever. He came up with the reason, explained it, and, most importantly, believed in what he was saying. I was slowly coming back to normal, and was hit by the horrible realization how my refusal must have looked. Here was a prideful shaman turning his nose up at the gifts of the emperor. I was lucky not to get docked reputation points for this.
You've shown me that I was wrong, continued the emperor. So we should once again return to the reward. This time you will have no choice,
I will decide what your reward should be. But this can wait. I can't stop thinking of the chess pieces standing in the main hall. They could have only been created by a cursed artificer. Did you hold such a title? I nodded, not understanding where the Emperor was going with all of this. And why did he say did rather than do? The amulet of the novice of Iluna could be made by any sentient that has a positive reputation with the priestesses. But you were a cursed artificer. Therefore, in order to create such a thing, you had to become a blessed artificer. Is that the case? I nodded once again, beginning to lose track with all these artificers. There were altogether too many of them.
Dad, I really don't understand what this is all about, said Tisha, who was still standing next to us.
Truth be told, she was voicing my thoughts too. I had no idea what it was that the Emperor wanted.
Come. The Emperor waved his hand and a portal opened nearby. I must show you something.
You have gained access to the Emperor's throne room. Current level of palace access, 46%. Next interior, the Emperor's office.
I waved away the message, for which many players would have easily given 2 years of play, and stepped into the portal. What was it that Nati needed? The answer was very unusual. A dagger was stuck right in the center of the throne. I could tell that this was a cursed object without even looking at its properties. The waves of darkness emanating from the dagger were being contained by statuettes of Iluna placed around the throne.
A present for the future emperor from Guernica, explained Nati. No one can touch the dagger. Neither the Emperor nor the Dark Lord. It can only be destroyed by combining it with a holy object, as I have just done. But there are very few of these throughout the Empire, and all of these are located in temples. Neither the throne nor those objects can be moved, otherwise they will lose their properties. The new High Priestess has shielded the effect of the dagger on the palace, but I cannot take my throne. An emperor cannot exist for long without his throne. In 4 months' time, I will disappear.
No!
Came a cry from Tisha.
Calm down, my dear. Not all is lost. In a week I will gather all the heroes of the Empire and ask for their help. According to these scrolls,
some scrolls appeared in the Emperor's hands,
a lost relic of light is located somewhere in the depths of the Free Lands. With its help, it will be possible to destroy this dagger. The heroes will have to meet very strict requirements, including a minimal level of 200. Their reputation with the Emperor will not be a factor. I am prepared to meet any exiles halfway and give them a second chance. Although, I'll weigh up all the pros and cons first.
So where do I fit into all of this? It looked like the scenario for the opening up of Cartus as a player faction was set to continue a week later and involve high-level players.
You are a blessed artificer. One can't depend entirely on the search for the relic being successful. For example, it may not be found within the given time. It is my duty as the Emperor to protect my empire from any risk, and you've given me a very interesting idea. Aside from the heroes of the Empire, I will give an assignment to each of the craftsmen. Instead of joining the search effort, they will have to create a holy artifact capable of destroying the dagger. Perhaps someone will succeed. You will be given this assignment right now, even though you don't meet the necessary parameters. As Beatwick had shown, sometimes it's worth taking a risk and trusting a low-level free citizen.
Quest available. Creation of a holy artifact. Description: The Malabar Empire is facing a calamity. A cursed dagger has been plunged deep into the heart of the throne. If it is not destroyed within 4 months, the emperor will perish. Create a holy item that could destroy the dagger. Reward: plus 500 reputation with the emperor, plus 15 levels, plus 50,000 gold coins, a scaling item from the emperor's stores. Penalty for failing the quest: none. Quest type: scenario. Requirements: at least 100 levels in the main profession. The quest cannot be completed if the level of the main profession is less than 100. Level restrictions: none. Time limit for completing the quest: 127 days from the moment it has been given out.
I will do everything in my power to destroy the dagger, were the only words I could force out of myself after reading through the quest description. Plus 15 levels. For this, Anastaria and Hellfire would drop everything and start crafting like mad. It's hard to get your character to level 100, but it is possible. Reaching level 200 would require a special effort. After level 300, however, each level gained is a real cause for celebration. And with this, you would get plus 15 all in one go.
I had no doubt that you would take up the challenge, said the Emperor solemnly. Now, let us once again return to the question of your reward. I think this would suit you better than the rest.
With these words, Naughty handed me the boots.
Wear them with pride.
I bowed as I accepted the Emperor's gift and finally had a look at the properties of my reward. What kind of an item was it impossible to get from the Thracinians?
Item acquired: Shaman's Boots of Brisk Running. Durability: unbreakable. Description: Shamans spend most of their lives on the road. Comfortable shoes are a guarantee of a happy and living shaman. Plus 40 to maximum level of energy. Spirit summoning time is reduced by 50%. Plus, player level 10, intellect. Plus, player level 5, stamina. Plus, player level 3, agility. Plus, player level 7, defense from all damage types. Item class: scaling, integrated. Level restrictions: none.
Finally, the hamster shook off his apathy. He was jumping happily around the boots, blowing specks of dust off them and looking at the emperor with love-filled eyes, solemnly promising to craft the holy artifact the very next day. Anything to get another bonus like this.
And one last thing. You may try to create the relic in Anhurs with the aid of the High Priestess, but I advise you to travel to the Freelands. There are many untapped resources there, some of which are probably of the hallowed kind. The choice remains up to you. I can only advise. And now, please excuse me. I have to leave you.
The Emperor gave me a brief nod, opened a portal, and a moment later I was alone with Tisha. I quickly put on the boots, in case anyone changed their mind, and sadly noted that the bonus from Rick's set disappeared. I had to choose, either to put on this new wonder or keep the bonuses from all the 8 items in the set. The boots were a clear winner.
Rick's gear would have to be changed soon in any case. I've outgrown it.
Where are you off to now?
It looked like Tisha would be sticking with the stunned princess role for some time. The change of emperor took place almost painlessly, and the developers had already come up with a mass quest for the players. But Tisha was still walking around in a state of shock. Could there be a quest tied to all this? I'm going to pay Beth a visit now. She asked me to drop by as soon as I came to Annhurst. Then I will go to the registrar and finally register my clan. And then we'll see.
Princess, can I be of any help to you?
Princess? That sounds so strange. Well, no, I...
Judging by the fact that Tisha was struggling to make up her mind about something, I must have been on the threshold of being given a new quest. I looked at my attractiveness to her. 39 points. Strange. With the ordinary girl Tisha in Beadwick, it was as high as 83, or thereabouts. But here, with her a princess, it was just 39.
Of course.
These were two different imitators, despite there being only one NPC. They reduced it by too much. It looks like I'll need at least 40 points to be given the quest. Damn. I have no way of increasing my score, either. I remembered the dress that I gave to Reptilus, and my inner greed toad came out of hibernation. Not only did that lizard fail to pay me the rest of what he owed me, although maybe he did do it, I've not been to the bank yet, I handed him an item that would have been really useful right now. All I would have had to do was make a gift of it to Tisha, and the princess would have been putty in my hands. Any quest, any help, within reason, of course. I was so stupid. Tisha, I said, risking calling the girl by her name. In Beatwick, there was no problem with calling NPCs by their first names, but this was the palace, and she was now the princess, so it could land me in real trouble. How about this? Right now I'll go and settle my affairs, then come back to the palace in the evening and we'll have a chat. I have access, even to the throne room, so we can meet on this very spot. We can have a proper talk then.
All right,
smiled the girl, as if a great weight had been lifted from her shoulders.
Until evening, then.
I barely had time to notice that I was alone. Tisha was gone in a flash. Great. So how will I make my way out of here? It's not like I know the plan of the palace.
The Emperor asked me to accompany you.
Like a genie from a bottle, a herald popped up next to me.
Where would you like to go?
I need to get to the High Priestess Eveluna, I said, quickly recomposing myself. Please transport me there, or, if you can't take me there directly, to the place where I can ask for an audience with her.
Please come this way.
The herald opened a portal, saying,
The High Priestess is ready to receive you.
Beth's office had quite a Spartan look. There was a simple table, snowed under with various papers, a wooden chair, and pale modest curtains that completely covered the walls. If this were reality, the curtains would have been sure to conceal a number of guards, ready to strike down anyone that threatened their mistress. In Barliona, however, I was quite sure that the curtains concealed shelves full of books and scrolls not meant for the eyes of ordinary mortals. Although ordinary mortals wouldn't have dreamt of being admitted to the office of the High Priestess, so the matter with the scrolls was worth further thought.
Man!
Beth was clearly happy to see me.
It's so good that you managed to get here quickly.
I have started to sort out the mess left behind by the previous High Priestess, which is mind-bogglingly terrible. There was no semblance of a system or proper record-keeping. I already demoted her to the rank of a novice. It's better for her to bring light and warmth to ordinary people than to do paperwork. That was never her strength. I'm sorry, but I have very little time, so I'll get straight to the point. What are your plans in the next 3 or 4 months?
I must create a holy item for the Emperor in order to free the throne, I answered honestly. There was little sense in doing anything else. My attractiveness with the High Priestess was at 91, and I was friendly with the priestesses of Aluna, so I could speak the truth, whatever it may be.
So, you already know? The Emperor has shared this secret with you?
Beth froze for a moment.
Then again, I shouldn't be surprised after everything that you've done.
After pausing briefly, Beth started to dig around amongst the files on her table. For a few moments, all I could hear was the rustle of paper and the subdued mutterings of the priestess.
Where is it? You could lose a herd of elephants in here. It's not an office. It's just one big mess. Finally! I can't give you back the ring, Beth continued, giving me a scroll. It vanished the moment I was back in Anhur's. But I owe you a great deal, so I'm offering you the rank of a priest of Aluna. You would skip the novice stage and immediately become a great priest. This matter has already been discussed with the Emperor, and he promised to help. Here's the draft of your agreement regarding the change of your class. You only have to sign it. To the player located in a prisoner capsule, in view of your arrival into the main game world and possession of a positive reputation with the leading NPCs of Malabar, Court Decision Number 45-RS344328 grants you the permission to change your character class. Proposed class, Great Priest. Chosen deity, Iluna, the Light Bearer. Do you agree to change your class, yes or no?
This offer is insufficient to express my gratitude, but I have to start somewhere, added Beth, awaiting my reply.
Suddenly, a veil seemed to obscure my sight, and a ringing sound filled my head. It was as if my blood pressure had shot up as a result of what I just heard. I even thought it a good idea to simply close my eyes and try to imagine that everything that just happened was a mistake, and that when I opened them again it would all disappear. But no. The system really was offering me to change my character class from the unpopular shaman to one of the most universal and esteemed classes. The ability to revive players during combat alone was worth a lot, and I would get all of this right now on the spot.
I can't.
I spoke with some effort, trying not to look Beth in the eye. Experience had taught me that those who consider shamans a weak class understand nothing in this game, and those who know the truth are keeping shtum about it.
You refuse?
Elizabeth lifted her eyebrows in surprise. Beth, please understand. Do you think I would have managed to do everything that I have if I wasn't a shaman? It's more than just a class. It's a certain way of thinking, acting, and feeling. You can't describe shamans in words. You can only feel them. I may make a good priest, but I would have to destroy an excelled shaman.
These are all just words. You think my gift unworthy of you?
Overcome with emotion, Beth jumped up from the chair. Why are women so difficult? Will I really have to lose reputation with the High Priestess if I wanted to remain a shaman? Beth, I never said anything of the sort. I can't become a priest. I'm a shaman.
You're a coward, not a shaman. You are being offered a big responsibility, and you're trying to wriggle out of it.
So that's how it is? Then it's time to bring out the heavy artillery. Beth, if Clowder, Avtendil, and Mariana were kidnapped by Cardus minions and you were given an ultimatum, either become a warrior or your children will die, what would you choose?
What? How dare you compare such things?
Shouted the priestess. My level of attractiveness in the NPC's properties began to plummet. Currently, it amounted to just 63 points, and if the conversation kept going in the same direction, I could forget about remaining in the High Priestess's favor, with all the ensuing consequences. Yes, I do dare. I had also raised my voice in response to Beth's shouting.
Do you think you're the only one in this position? You think that because I'm a shaman, I have no responsibilities? Tell me, what would you do?
You are forgetting yourself, elemental shaman.
Beth cut me off sharply, emphasizing the last word. By now, attractiveness had reached 47.
Fine, I will reply for you, I continued. What did you say in Beatwick? Let the children go, we'll stay behind and try to slow them down. You're prepared to face death for the sake of your children, so why do you think that I...
Yes, I would give up everything just so they could live.
Attractiveness was at 34.
But what do you, a male, free citizen, know about children? How can you compare parts of me that have gained their own being with your shamanism?
We had arrived at the moment of truth, the point towards which I had been driving all this time. I was ready to get to the heart of my argument with Beth. Let's see, O High One, what you'll say to this, I thought. I wasn't even looking at the change of class message. The constantly flashing yes, no buttons distracted me only for the first few seconds. Now, as our conversation had descended into shouting, they had grown dim and almost evaporated. I don't need this. I'm a shaman. Draco, come to me. We need to sort something out.
Coming. Hello, brother. Did you call me?
Draco appeared right next to me.
Do you remember him?
I asked Elizabeth, who stared at the dragon, eyes wide.
He was playing with your son. If I become a priest, he will disappear. Forever.
Tell me, does he really deserve to be destroyed? Is the rank of the great priest worth the knowledge for the remainder of my life that I was responsible for destroying a dragon?
I'm prepared to fall out with you completely and forever be barred from Iluna's temple as long as my brother remains alive.
Damn. I failed to restrain myself and broke into screaming towards the end. It came out altogether too emotional in the end.
I forgot, said the priestess, stunned.
And I was pleased to see that my attractiveness returned to its initial 91 points, even overshooting to reach 93. I even gained reputation now.
Forgive me,
I...
The priestess's eyes filled with tears.
Forgive me.
Beth, I am very grateful to you for your offer, but you can see for yourself that it was never going to be possible for me.
But I wished it for all the best reasons. I thought being a priest was such a high honor. Do you see this pile?
Beth nodded in the direction of the pile of papers.
These are all requests from free citizen priests to retake the rank initiation test. Currently, there are over 1 million of these priests of Illumina in Malabar, and that number is growing every day. I don't know how many priests other gods have, but they are also quite numerous. So, I thought...
And you thought you would make me a great one straight away, right? When I know nothing about what it means to be a real priest? After all, there's a reason that people spend so long in the rank of a novice. You have to learn how to communicate with the goddess and how to master your power. And here, a former shaman would become a great priest. Everyone in Anhurst would laugh if I tried to say a prayer.
That's not that important. You would have learned quickly, so I wouldn't have accepted such a reason for your refusal. But a dragon?
Beth came up to him and looked at me.
Can I touch him? I really wanted to do that when my son was playing with him, but I was too afraid.
What about you, Draco? You don't mind?
Of course not. I like it when people pet me.
Draco put out his head towards the priestess, expecting to be stroked.
Now I can see that for you he is a person and not just a totem,
the High Priestess said solemnly, in fact, not reaching out to touch the dragon after all.
You are a worthy shaman, and long may you remain this way. The choice of the character class has been made. Changes have been recorded. Current class, Elemental Shaman. Now, let's get down to business.
Beth quickly changed the topic.
I asked you about time for a reason. Mayan, the priestesses of Illumina need your help. Quest available. Restoration of a holy relic. Step 1. The history of the missionaries of Illumina. Description. Listen to the High Priestess and learn the story of the missionaries of Illumina. Requirements. Reputation with Goddess Illumina is greater than 0. Reputation with the priestesses of Goddess Illumina is friendly or higher. Quest chain class. Rare. Reward for completing step 1 is plus 1500 experience, plus 100 reputation with the priestesses of Illumina. Reward for the quest chain? Variable. Penalty for failing or refusing the quest? Neutral status with Goddess Illumina.
I will do everything I can to help the priestesses. I didn't hesitate for a moment in accepting the quest. Something interesting was afoot, and I wanted in.
10 years ago...
Beth began the tale after settling in a seat behind her table, before abruptly interrupting herself.
Let your dragon go. There's no reason for him to keep doing laps in my office.
She continued.
Now then, 10 years ago, as soon as I was removed from the position of the High Priestess and sent into exile, a missionary expedition was sent to the Free Lands. It was comprised of 40 novices, 10 junior and 5 ordinary priests, and the mission was headed by the great priest Midial. Other than the priests, 200 warriors and 50 mages joined the expedition. All of them were at level 200. The official purpose of the mission was to expand Illumina's zone of influence in the Free Lands. But this was a cover.
Midial's main aim was to find the Tear of Iluna, the lost amulet of the High Priestesses. According to our archives, it was last seen in that region. As you can probably guess, the missionary party disappeared. Neither Midial nor anyone else from the group ever came back, and all their communication amulets ceased to function. What happened to them is anyone's guess. What is more important is that the great priest took with him the Stone of Light, and it hasn't been seen since.
The Stone of Light? I interrupted Beth, seeking a bit more detail on this point. What's that?
A concentration of divine light. With its help, priestesses can either drive back darkness or completely restore their strength. With just one use, the stone can restore the power of 2 great or 20 ordinary priests. Afterwards, it needs to be recharged. The recharging happens in a temple. If the stone is placed on an altar, just 2 hours later, it's ready for use again. These stones can have different appearances. Some look like ordinary rocks, and others are statuettes. All the Stones of Light located in Anhurs are currently standing around the Emperor's throne, shielding the palace from Guernica's cursed dagger. The recipe for making the stones has been lost, so each specimen is precious. This is the complete story. On behalf of the priestesses of Iluna, I ask that you travel to the Free Lands and return with the Stone of Light. Quest: Restoration of a Holy Relic, Step 1. The history of the missionaries of Iluna has been completed. Reward: +1500 experience, +100 reputation with the priestesses of Iluna. Quest available: Restoration of a Holy Relic, Step 2. Search for the Stone of Light. Description: Go to the Freelands. Find the lost Stone of Light that was once in the possession of the great priest Midial and find out what happened to the missionaries. Requirements: Reputation with Goddess Iluna is greater than 0. Reputation with the priestesses of Goddess Iluna is friendly or above. Combined group level is 600. Quest chain class, rare. Reward for completing step 2, +35,000 experience, +500 reputation with the priestesses of Iluna, +100 reputation with Goddess Iluna. Reward for the quest chain, hidden. Penalty for failing or refusing the quest, none.
One more thing, added Beth at the end. You can't travel to the Freelands alone. You will need helpers. I will mark your map with the place where the missionary expedition was headed, but if the level of your group is insufficient, this mark will disappear. Please, don't go by yourself. It's very dangerous.
I won't go alone, I assured Beth, turning over all my acquaintances in my mind. The combined level of 600 is quite a lot. On the one hand, that's just Anastaria and Hellfire together, but I had no intention of handing this quest over to them. I had to get back in touch with my old connections, find Eric and company, and quickly level up. How much time do I have to find it? If the quest could be postponed by a month, I might have a chance to level up at breakneck speed and gain a dozen levels, irrespective of Evelyn's emphatic threats. That would be great.
The sooner the better, but you do have 2 months. Gather your team and return to me. You will all be sent by teleportation to the borders of the Freelands. A month later, I will send other teams. I'm sorry, but this matter is just too important. If we don't hear news from you, I will have to appeal for help from the heroes of the Empire.
the stone must be returned. Changes to the quest, restoration of the holy relic, step 2, searching for the stone of light. Time given for completion, 2 months.
I hope you will return with the stone, said Beth finally. And now you must excuse me. I am catastrophically behind in getting my affairs in order. Oh, what's wrong with me? I still haven't thanked you for the rescue. The great priest rank wasn't even the main reward. It's this, said Beth, taking out a small box from under her table.
Iluna's high priestess is really quite something. So changeable that you end up feeling you're dealing with a child. She switches to a new topic every 10 minutes. Any longer than that, and her brain just gets too tired. It made me wonder if this imitator got a concussion in Beatwick.
It may not be the Emperor's ring, but you may still find it useful. Wear it honorably.
Beth opened the lid of the box and took out a ring. She looked at it closely for a couple of seconds, as if searching for a flaw, and then handed it to me.
Item acquired. Holy Ring of Iluna. Description, +20% experience gain. Requirements, reputation with the priestesses of Goddess Iluna, friendly or higher. Item class, unusual, blessed.
Minimal description, but the effect was simply amazing. So, blessed items can be rather useful.
That's it. Blessed items. Beth, I also have a certain matter to discuss with you. I've made so many cursed things in Beatwick, it's crazy. I still have some of that dubious ore left as well. Can you bless all of these things? I can't sell them, and it seems a pity to just throw all of it away.
Of course, put them all on the table. It's time to give my priestesses some proper work. They could use a break from all the heavy-duty flirting with the guards. You can come and collect all of this tomorrow.
Great! Then I'm off to gather my team. The stone will be found. I put on the new ring and headed for the bank of Barliona. A flashing pictogram in the form of a letter had been trying to catch my attention for the best part of the last 10 minutes. This could mean only one thing. I had a message in the mail. Of all possible limitations, I only had tax and the presence of pain remaining, so little comforts like notifications and internal clan chats were now accessible. But who could be so keen to get hold of me?
Chapter 2. Sea Thistles.
"How can I help you?"
the Bank of Barliona gremlin asked in a squeaky voice as his dark eyes looked up at me. "I'd like to get a personal mailbox that would permit me to send mail from anywhere. I was finally getting around to buying the most important item in Barliona, the basic portable mailbox. Many players head to the bank and buy this useful device on the very first day they roll up a character. Now there would be no need to run to the bank every time I had to send a message or read a letter. I'd have it all right there in my pocket. Of course, the basic version doesn't have all the nice features with settings, content sorting, and use of the male intellect imitator, but I saw little sense in buying the enhanced version to get all these things. It's not like I was expecting mountains of mail.
The annual cost of the basic portable mailbox service is 200 gold. Do you wish to make the purchase?
But it used to cost 500,
I exclaimed involuntarily, greatly surprised by the unexpected decrease in the cost of the service. Lowering prices in any way, let alone having them, seemed out of line with the corporation's usual way of doing things.
This is the policy of the Bank of Barliona
towards persons that have achieved respect with the Emperor," the gremlin said, somewhat pompously, tearing himself away from his papers. "Should you reach exalted, this service would be provided free of charge. Do you wish to acquire the mailbox?"
"Well, I'll be. When I played as a hunter, I hadn't managed to increase my reputation with the Emperor by a single point, and had no idea about a nice perk like that. The saving of 300 a year may not be huge, but was still nice." "Yes, I do. Please deduct the sum from my account." I confirmed the message that popped up about the deducted amount and again turned to the gremlin.
"Your portable mailbox."
I was handed a small folder, showily tied together with a red ribbon. "Item acquired. Basic portable mailbox. Description: you shall now be able to send and receive mail from any location in Barliona. Annual service cost of mailbox, 200 gold. Does not take up inventory bag space." I thanked the gremlin and entered my personal room. The flashing icon indicating new mail didn't go anywhere and was telling me that I had 5 letters waiting for me now. I sat down on the uncomfortable chair, noting that I should look into expanding my personal space here to reduce general discomfort, and opened the first letter.
"Only today, new erotic show with a copy of The Great Anastaria, 21 plus. Ticket price, 2,300 gold, video recording prohibited. Show venue, the Anhurs Dating House."
Well, I'll be. Spam. Real, genuine spam. It really has been a while. The filters that I had turned on when I was in Beatwick blocked all mail except that sent directly by other players, so in the past 6 months I hadn't seen any bulk messages. After adding the sender to the blacklist to prevent similar messages getting through, I continued to read the rest.
"Clan Ponage Meisters invites you into its ranks. We have a friendly and fun team, and all you need to do is bring your first kill. Repair covered by the clan. We have our own repair experts. Clan Triple X invites you."
And 20 more letters with similar offers. I went through them one by one, wondering why I was never notified of their arrival, and then noticed their date. Most of the letters had arrived well before the events in Beatwick, when I was still under my parole limitations. 5 had arrived just in the 2 hours that had elapsed since my virtual freedom, and here was I thinking that I had received something important, got my hopes up, and all that. I continued looking through the letters with dampened enthusiasm, gradually forming a blacklist of my own. Just in the last few minutes, 4 more spam letters had arrived. Then I finally came across something unusual. A letter from Evelyn. The envelope had a pictogram of a box next to it, indicating an attachment. I pressed the pictogram and saw the list of things that had been sent to me. 57 scrolls, all jewelcraft recipes, judging by the description. Right. What's in the message, then?
"Hello, Mayan. First of all, I would like to apologize for the performance that I had to put on today, but everything had to look genuine to the heralds. Imitators, no way around it. I believe that the enormous boon that you managed to hand my clan merits an explanation on my part. So, here it is. The idea of letting people play on the side of Cartus has been floating around the corporation for some time. They did their best to keep a lid on it, but you can't get away from the human factor in the workforce. So, if you know your way around the net, not only can you find the description of all the new races and classes, but also make an approximate prediction of the update's release date. About 6 months ago, it became clear that all the preparations have been completed and that the corporation was ready to launch the scenario. By some unfathomable miracle, you have ended up being part of it, so I can only hope that your luck will hold out. As soon as the heralds told us that members of the clan have been banned from appearing in the Krong province, it became clear that the scenario had commenced. Constantly coming second can get very tedious, so the decision to transfer the clan to Cartus was taken at the clan assembly. We conducted a clan-wide survey and established our base, 4,000 players who were prepared to move to Cartus. The rest of the rabble was removed from the clan, just as Plinto was. Unfortunately, people like him are uncontrollable. Please keep that in mind when creating your own clan. So all we had to do was wait for the start of the transfer and become the first clan of the Dark Empire. That is when I had a very interesting idea. According to the rumors that reached me, the worse your reputation with the Emperor and the Empire, the easier it would be to transfer your clan, even going as far as gaining respect with Cartus and the Dark Lord. At the clan assembly, we decided to put a player with a positive reputation with both required factions on our official blacklist, so we could end up deep in the minus. It's not possible to just add people to this list on a whim. You need approval of a herald and a dramatic performance. Everything had to be official and clear, including the over-the-top rhetoric. Otherwise, it wouldn't have worked. So I played my part in the theatrics. We've spent some time looking for a victim, even considering adding Eckler at first. But he had positive reputation with too many useful factions with which we also would have preferred to remain on good terms. Thracinians, for example. And then you turned up. The Emperor expressed his gratitude to you, and this could only mean that your reputation with him is higher than friendly. Then I took a chance, and, as you can see, hit the mark. Aside from the Malabar factions, you don't have any reputation leveled above friendly. Just moments after the Herald took you away, I was contacted by the representatives of the corporation expressing their thanks for finding a loophole that allowed a very favorable migration to Cartus. This move has already been blocked, so it can't be used a second time, but our clan was left as it was. We acted within the framework of the game and didn't break any rules, so there won't be any penalties imposed on Dark Legion. Thus, when in 3 weeks' time we migrate to the other empire, we will already have respect with Cartus and the Dark Lord. I realize that the next 3 weeks will be very tough for you, and would like to offer you at least some compensation for the moral damages suffered on my account. I know that you are a very skilled and exceptional jeweler. The cursed chess pieces are proof of this. So I'm sending you jewelcraft recipes that cannot be bought from the trainers. All of them are drops from dungeon bosses, and all are of rare, and some even epic, quality. So I believe they should be sufficient to compensate you for any distress you might experience. I don't want to send you money, as that's unimaginative and will mean that I've bought you. Yours sincerely, the head of the Dark Legion clan, Everlet. P.S. I hope my idea will not affect the clan's reputation with the Dark Lord. As far as I know, you are in good standing with him as well. It would be a great pity to make that mistake. P.P.S. Try to vanish from places frequented by players for the next 3 weeks. Take a trip to the Freelands. Go on a walkabout or focus on leveling up. Neither I nor the Dark Legion clan have any desire to be constantly sending you for respawn. P.P.P.S. Rather a lot of postscripts here. The only thing I will really miss is the cursed chess pieces. They will disappear the moment we move to Cartus. This has already been verified. I hope that the recipes that I sent will aid you in creating something as beautiful and magnificent.
All this hit me like a bolt out of the blue. There was so much information, and all of it so interesting. It was quite overwhelming. Plinto was removed from the clan because he was uncontrollable. I now have a ton of recipes that were not normally available for sale. The Dark Legion is preparing to migrate to the dark side. Stop. Shouldn't I have a letter about that as well? Only 2 unread letters remained. I looked at the senders. Barliona Administration and Reptilis. Reptilis's letter came with an attachment. That green lizard probably sent me the rest of the money he owed me, so that can wait.
Dear player, we would like to inform you that from today you have the opportunity to transfer your character to the side of the Cartus Empire. If you decide to take this step, utter the phrase, "I call upon a magister, I request your assistance," and you will be teleported to the nameless city, the capital of Cartus, and offered the choice of a new race and class. You can find the description of all races and classes in the game manual. Number of times you can refuse to change your empire, not more than 2. After the second refusal, the transfer of the character will become impossible. Duration, 1 month from the moment you read this letter. To the owners of the clans, you can transfer your clan to the dark side of Cartus only if you have the written agreement of each clan member. Yours sincerely, Barliona Administration.
A transfer to Cartus. Maybe I should just throw in the towel now and become a Dark One? I opened the manual and immersed myself in reading. Trolls, Thorin, undead, ogres, dark bloods, ashen elves. Well, I'll be. Over 20 previously inaccessible new races. For players who love everything new, this was paradise. New quests, new lands, new skills, new everything. I thought about moving to Cartus for a few seconds, but then smiled and shooed that thought away. I'm quite happy in Malabar, as it happens.
Hi, Mayan. This is Reptilis, the one you sold the dress to. Here is the remainder of the money, and huge thanks for the dress. I'm lost for words in expressing my gratitude. Once again, please accept my apologies for trying to lead you like a sheep to the slaughter. I had no idea that things would turn out this way. If you ever need help, just say the word. I'll do all that's in my power straight away. Tillis.
So, it looks like Anastaria did like my dress after all. The greed toad heaved a deep sigh one last time, and with sadness saw the 24,500 gold drop into my purse. The time had come for me to reap the results of my work. I opened the folder and started to write letters. Hello, Marina. Listen, you know that I've been put on the Dark Legion blacklist, so I'll be in hiding for the next 3 weeks. Consequently, it won't be possible to meet up with you in the near future. Let's do the following. As soon as I know that I'm no longer under threat, I'll contact you. Daniel.
This player is not currently in the game. Your letter will be delivered later.
First of all, I postponed the meeting with Mirida to an unspecified point in the future. I had already decided that we should meet, so it made sense to warn her that I was about to vanish for an uncertain amount of time. Something was telling me that I had to speak with her. But to be honest, I had to admit that I was afraid of this meeting. In the first few months, I would have given a lot to look Marina in the eyes, but now, after I had actually seen those eyes, even just those of her avatar, I had no negative feelings towards her. I realized that I felt neither anger nor rage. Emotions had ebbed away, leaving only the harsh reality behind. Still, it felt so strange to sign with my real name. I had become so unused to it in the last half a year that I had begun to forget it. I had to try to use it more often, or after my release in 7 years' time, I would still be insisting that my name is Mahan. Right after the letter to Marina, I wrote letters to my former acquaintances, with whom I've played for almost a year and a half, and asked to meet with them. I urgently had to gather my own team, preferably made up of people that I had known before. Elinium was a junior priest of Eluna. Since we were going on a quest handed to us by priestesses, he was bound to get some special bonus out of it. Just a few months before I ended up in prison, Sergei, as he was called in real life, had become a father, so he disappeared from Barliona for a while. I hoped that his little son was doing well and that Elinium was still playing. Duki was a rogue. In real life, he was Johannes, from some Berlin suburb. He was an interesting guy, with whom you could talk about almost anything, ramble through an adventure together, and generally have a great time. That's as long as he keeps his feet on the brakes. If Duki really lets rip, you'd better hang on. I've hardly ever seen such a nitpicky brainiac. Sushiho was a necromancer. Real name, Paolo, a genuine citizen of Rome. He was a 2-meter-tall teacher of Eastern martial arts, but chose a little gnome as his game character. He wanted to cast himself against type, and he managed it very well. We met up outside the game a couple of times, and we always treated this giant as a shorty. All of us spent a great deal of time together, and even wanted to form our own clan, but never got around to it. Now, there was finally an opportunity to make those old dreams a reality. On several occasions, after getting out of the mine, I almost wrote to them, but each time something stopped me. Although this was no something, I know exactly what it was. I didn't want to hang my problems on others. Even if I wrote to them that everything was fine, I would have had to tell them about everything that had happened. What was the sense of burdening them with such boring and unnecessary information as my imprisonment? After these guys, the list of my good acquaintances had run out. Now only Eric, Klutzer, and Leidy remained. I had known these three for only 2 weeks, but in that time they had shown themselves to be real men,
So I immediately wrote a letter to each of them, proposing that we should meet up tomorrow morning at the Jolly Noom Tavern. The blacklist kicked into action only at the end of tomorrow, so I had a little bit of time on my hands. I think that's it. Although, no. There was one more outstanding debt that simply had to be settled. I opened the map of Cardis that I got from the leader of the Dark Goblin mining incursion. It contained 20% of the old Cardis territories. I wondered whether the map remained current or became seriously outdated after the game update. A good question to which I would have loved to know the answer. But this wasn't that important right now. When he sent me that small mountain of jewelcraft recipes, Evelyn handed me a truly massive gift. I had to give him a corresponding reply. I highlighted several areas of the map close to the capital, made a copy of these, and sent it to the leader of the Dark Legion clan under the heading, "A Favor Returned." I may have only shared half of my 20% with him, but I thought this was sufficient not to feel indebted for the rest of my life. The greed toad prevented me from sending the entire map, having risen up in arms in defense of its interests. Now, I really was done. I've sent out all the warnings, meeting requests, and thanks. I could now proceed to pat myself on the back. Although, on reflection, there was one more thing I needed to take care of. Anastaria. The thought of my scaling items was bothering me. What if they get forgotten? Despite there being an agreement in place, unbreakable as it was, I'd still rather play it safe and refresh the memory of the party involved. Speaking, Anastaria's divine voice filled my personal bankroom. Anastaria, this is Mahan. Have you already been transported?
No, we had to port ourselves. To what do I owe the honor? I'm beginning to fear calls from you.
Judging by the girl's cheerful voice, she was laughing.
You either chuck me into some backwater shrubbery or turn up demanding to steer a raid. What did you find this time?
No, I'm calling you about a totally mercantile matter right now. When can I get the Thracinian items that Phoenix promised me? You see, Evelyn just declared open season on me, so it would be good to get them now, and not in 3 weeks' time.
Not right now. I'm not in Anhurs. Let's meet in 2 or 3 hours. It will be just gone midnight, and there will be fewer people around. You could barely squeeze through the crowd stomping through the city right now. Let's meet on the central square. The Thracinian place is located nearby. That work for you?
All right. I'll see you in a couple of hours. I am already on the square. Just dial me as soon as you're here, and I'll come right away. I'll have a look around the shops in the meantime.
Good. Catch you later, then.
Anastaria disconnected, but I was wary of her good mood. She was suddenly very calm and approachable. Something wasn't right here. I would have to be very careful during our meeting and keep my tongue in check. I was about to leave, but then saw that I had just received another letter. Strange. Everyone seems to be writing to me these days. I opened the folder and looked at the author. It was Evelyn.
Mahan, we urgently need to meet. In 10 minutes, in the Golden Horseshoe Tavern. It's on the central square in Anhurs. I've reserved a table. Evelyn.
I'm looking for a decent clan to transfer to Cardis. Those headed for Cardis, join us. It would be easier in a clan. Selling 20 black fox pelts, 10 gold each.
The last message stuck out of the general flow of messages like a sore thumb. Anhurs had descended into the chaos of people preparing to move to the nameless city, and I cringed as if beset by toothache.
How could I forget that aside from the advantages of being a free citizen, there were also the downsides, such as general city chat? Although Farstead also came with various messages from players, they didn't form such an endless din that was now stressing out my ears. Until you fix the general chat settings, filtering out the unwanted channels, you end up hearing and reading everything on offer from players across Anhurs. Obvious trolling and flooding were forbidden, with the imitators keeping a close eye on this, but even just the shouts searching for groups and seeking sale or exchange of goods combined into an endless clamor. When I was walking to the bank, I didn't take any notice of this, but now the players were really letting rip. Cardus beckoned for many. I quickly went to the settings and added a filter, which sorted types of messages into groups, then breathed a sigh of relief and headed to the tavern. On the outside, with its gray walls, dingy doors, and dirty windows, the Golden Horseshoe didn't stand out in any way, but that didn't stop it being the most expensive tavern in the capital, and therefore the whole of Malabar. This was the place where Barliona's elite would head to celebrate the successful completion of a mission or a raid. Phoenix is thought to have started this tradition by holding a great party there after it won its first prize for completing a dungeon. Only players who specialized in cooking could be chefs in the Golden Horseshoe, and they were paid a handsome salary for their work. Each year, this elite tavern held contests for the best chef in Malabar, offering a job to the winner. And the competition for this position could be stiffer than for gaining the Best Clan title. Just the names of the dishes were quite taxing on the brain, as you struggle to imagine something like grilled flying camartin with slices of devil sore served under Rwandan rosemary sauce, sautéed crocolisk in fox rabbit skin. The dishes' names certainly created an impression. I opened a squeaky door, noting that at least in this regard the developers didn't have to overdo it, and found myself in a fairy tale. Firstly, I immediately found myself in a tuxedo. The system determined that I had a right to enter the building and dressed me in what suited the status of the establishment. The tux was an ordinary illusion, not affecting the stats of my gear in any way. But it still felt very strange. You had to know how to wear a tuxedo. Otherwise, it would end up looking like it was stuck on a mannequin. A couple of steps later, I realized that it was a skill I completely lacked. Secondly, the inner decor of the establishment presented a stark contrast to its external look. There was gold, crystal, sparkle, and, for some reason, red satin that pretty much summed up the dazzling sight that met me. Everything was so rich and expensive that I couldn't help feeling totally out of place here. With my paltry 60 and a bit thousand gold, I had no business being here. It would have only bought me the entrance fee and a couple of appetizers. Drinks were out of the question.
"Please, you're expected."
One of the waiters distracted me from close examination of a statue depicting a battle of an orc and a dinosaur. I was being addressed by a player. That was the way things were done in the Golden Horseshoe.
"Well, hello once again, you walking surprise,"
Evelyn greeted me cheerfully from a sumptuous armchair. An identical tuxedo to the one I was wearing looked so natural on him that I felt embarrassed by my own stiffness. A snow-white napkin, as if any spills or crumbs were even possible in Barliona, was lying on his knees. The table occupied by the leader of Dark Legion was laid out for two people, and the selection of silverware provided was pushing the boundaries of reasons.
5 spoons, and 6 forks. What was this? Did someone want to humiliate me?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.